In this episode of Finno-Greek Machining, we are going to install an ARO for the Z-axis of my lathe. So let's start with that one. So, let me present you the ARO. ARO. Mechanical travel indicator. Nothing more than that. First of all, we have here what it consists of. There is this spinning disc, which has divisions here, 0 to 100 actually, and then we have this vernier scale here. So yeah, one rotation here equals to 100 millimeters. So this is capable of measuring in 1/10 of a millimeter accuracy directly. Okay, very good. And then we have here in the backside, we have this is the brains of the operation, so to say. This disc here, this thing that rotates here, is connected to the disc here, and this one is very special. It has a very accurate diameter. It's hardened and it's ground to a very specific diameter. It's a precision component. Nothing else is really really like a precision in this device, only this one. Of course, maybe the bearings there inside, they are also something special. And then we have just a protective cap here, which is keeping the dust away from this wheel. There is a felt fabric here, which is then supposed to wipe off if you have cuttings or chips, so they don't enter between this and the measured thing. Okay, and now how this device is supposed to work? Well, in its originally, it was attached to the carriage on one end, and then it was leaning against the way, like this. Oh, where can I show it to you? Let's go here, maybe. I need room here. Okay, it was leaning against the way, like this. And then when the carriage moved, this rotates along, like this. And it's amazingly accurate, this device. So, the only things that can render the accuracy, first of all, if you have chips there, that will. And then again, if this carriage stops abruptly, like onto a wall, then the inertia of this wheel will actually drive it a little bit off the place. So yeah, okay. So that's mechanical travel indicator. So ARO, analog readout. Okay, so now, I would like to have this on my lathe because I just love mechanical things. This doesn't need any batteries, it doesn't have numerical displays. You can do estimations with this one. So, if I put it this way, as it is supposed to be, you can see that it's not very good thing. It will collide with my handles here, and I would be installed it so far away from that this is already like floppy. And then you cannot install it. You might think that, okay, let's install it to the other side here. First of all, it would be reading the wrong way around, and then I would be colliding with my desktop. Not a good thing. Another place where I have thought that it might probably be is here in this corner. Well, hard to read, and then it would interfere with my work pieces, and especially when I put the big four-charge chuck here, it would be horrible thing. So no. And this corner is also already so occupied that there is no way to do that. So we have to find here an alternative place for this one. And well, this is what I have thought, and this is how I will do it. So first of all, it doesn't need to be upright like this. And then this doesn't need to be like on a flat surface. It can also be like this. For example, you can measure it like this. It works like this if you want. But unfortunately, this also has some issues with colliding with things there. And no, it's not a good solution. Then I could put it here under, and that would be a very good solution. But then again, we have at some point we have issues with this one, because I would like to have it very near here. But and now comes the solution which I thought that might be possible. Is to put it not straight, but there is a chamfer here in under here. It's not a sharp corner, there is a chamfer, very exactly ground chamfer. Very good. It's about 1 millimeter wide. That's enough. So if I put it like this here, so then I can I have room for my when I place it correctly, notice. So then I have room for this. If I put it like here, I have room for that one. Okay. And then I also can operate. If I now, I wish I would have three hands now. This is a little bit strange. Okay. So if I put it here, I can also put it in a place when it I can use. You cannot see it because of my hands. If I put it like this, this can also be operated very easily. So that is the place where it comes. And now comes the hard part, which I really don't like. And in order to attach it this to somewhere, there is a hole here behind. And then we have this locking thing, this, which has this, well, groove, if you like, there. And then when you tighten this nut and there is a rod inside there, it will grip into that one and hold it in place. Good. Okay. But I need something for, so all that is needed for this one is a rod. And to get a rod here, well, this is something that probably needs drilling and tapping holes into this casting. And well, that's the part I really don't like. But well, I need to inspect some manuals, the service guide, etc. to see how thick this probably is, but I assume it's really thick because we have bolts. For example, here we have an this is M8, I believe, M8 bolt, which is requires then about, there is probably 10 millimeters thick. And if I attach it with, let's say, 4, or probably 5 M6 bolts here, They don't need to be 10 millimeters deep. I can leave them quite shallow and then use probably studs so that I don't stress the... if I put studs there, so then I can leave them there, and if I need to remove this, I will be thinking about this, how to do this, but that's not very bad. The only bad thing is to drill the holes for this casting, and I really, really, really don't like that. And then I would like to get rid of this cup. Well, if it's sitting like this here, if it is sitting like this, it doesn't protect. It will actually collect the chips into there. And that's a bad, bad, bad thing. No chips there, please. Well, okay, let's take this apart. If it comes. I have loosened it. So that's the precision thing. And this is the cup, which now I don't like at this case. And as you can see, we have a bearing there. And now if I put it like this there, so the bearing is exposed to the elements. Not very good. So I need to make some protective thing, which is actually replacing this cup, so that it is there in between and protects the bearing down there inside. Well, by the way, there is a taper in this one. So when I really, it was somewhat hard to get out from there, but not that hard, but it's somewhat. So this, there is a taper which is actually a normal DIN 9 taper. So it's the same taper as with tapered pins, for example. The same taper. So, yeah. So, our first task is to make this cover here. And this I won't throw away, because this is a historical device. This is really, I don't know whether you noticed, but it's in pristine condition. It's, it's really nice. So, going to put it here, going to make it's just like a small bushing, which has this kind of a groove, like this one has a groove. There will be three screws here, which lock it into place, and then there you are. And furthermore, one more thing about this, when it goes there and is actually interfering with the edge of here, the chamfer. Well, some of you might think that, okay, that's a point contact. Well, however accurately you try to adjust this device, you will always get a point contact, really. If you now can see about this, you can see the shiny part here. I cleaned this up, but so there is this shiny part, and then there is this not so shiny part. This shiny part has been in the previous user. This is the part that made the contact with the vase, and it has not been contacting here. So and to my knowledge, it's very hard to get this so straight on a way that it makes like a line contact. So, and if you think about the surface area of a line or a point, well, they are the same. Mathematically, they are the same. So therefore, I think that I can use this edge here. It's in convenient place, and furthermore, this thing, when it's in there, it's in a very good angle for reading. That's also important, that you don't need to, so it's really easy to read. So Now, let's start making this bushing here first. So, 42 millimeter piece of cold rolled steel. Quite a hefty piece and quite a lot of stick out here. Well, despite that, I need to face it. And then I can get a center support here. So, now, turn the machine on. And this one, well, maybe I need to be a little bit careful here. Well, I will run it quite fast, even though, let's see now how it runs. Not too wobbly. And then I will just touch and paste it. Let's now check one more time that I really tightened this. Yes, I did. Seems. And I tightened this as well. That's the one I always forget. And then let's fish for high spots here. That's one high spot. Okay. I lock the carriage here. So. And the facing direction I need to direction here is correct. And then I will feed with the compound this time. Oh yeah, okay. Let's and now of course protective eye protection is needed. This can throw chips. Yeah, it's a really throwing chips. I'm just feeding manually this time. And yeah, I feed quite well. Let's see how much we have. Oh, that was surprisingly well. So, let's see about this dial here. I take 2/10 only. I don't want to take any more than that. Yeah, 2/10. Okay, let's go. Not work well at least, but we are almost there. Okay, maybe if I feed it manually, so then it's a I will feed this manually. Oh, that sound was not good. That usually means that I chip my insert. Let's see. And yes, I did. I have to turn this around. Okay, now it's around. Hopefully I don't chip it again. Oh. It's time. hope it breaks the chips. That's the theme of today. Chip control. So to say, let's touch it. It's not concentric. Talking, and I believe we are quite near our dimension. It doesn't matter if it is a little bit over, it can also be a little bit under, and this is like 300ths of a millimeter. Maybe this focus can be seen. So it's 300ths of a millimeter over. It's okay. This is really sharp. It's razor sharp. So what I need to do now is to make a tiny chamfer into there. Just a tiny, nothing much. That's enough. Well, it's still semi-sharp. But not that sharp anymore. put the next gear on. There you are, maybe. I can cut this bit by hand. One thing, when you are sawing with your where is my putzlumpe. So one thing what can happen is that your saw drops to the waist and you damage your waist by this hacksaw. So this is there you are. Now chucking this into here without harming the surface. Well, I have here, this is a 0.1 millimeter copper film. Well, I just take about that wide from that. This is just, let's see. I have a lot of this stuff around. Maybe that was not enough. Man, hopefully. I should get two turns here. Well, I don't. It has to be longer. Man. Okay, but we have the other side here. So, let's take a little bit longer and wide. A bit longer, like that. Now we should be there. So I want to have two turns of this because this is so thin. So that's one. Is there. And then the second turn should end somewhere there. And you have to have good scissors to work with this material, and then I need to be able to measure it. Well, it didn't. It really didn't. No markings there at all. So let's take half of this. Well, it's 0.15 maybe, and there is some cosine error here. So okay, I'll accept that one. Of course, it can wiggle whatever way because well, I should measure it like, can I measure it here without, yeah, well. So if this is now high, so high is exactly there. If I move it to here and see how much do we have here, 400s. Okay, and then here, same 400s. Okay. that's straight enough for me. Not mild steel, that's for sure. This does. Yeah, now it slips in and doesn't wiggle. Good. Well, this is just, not too much anyway. Just here. This is a recess for the center of the bearing, so it doesn't touch this when it rotates. That's okay. And that detail was not in the original part. Now chamfering this with the center drill. I choose a very large center drill, so I can chamfer it because I'm going to use a live center here when I'm making the groove. It might slip in the jaw, so that's just a precaution. So therefore I make a sample with this center drill. Hopefully it works. Well, of course it works. Well, it resonates. But that's enough. We don't need any more than that. There you are. We have a center. And I'm running this at 800 revolutions per minute and feeding with compound by hand. Trying to make half a millimeter cuts. is the last millimeter. There you are. There is your chamfer. Okay. So it's a full turn and 1 millimeter. This is the piece we just made. So, and now when I put it here, it fits in quite nicely there. There is a color difference. Well, you probably cannot see it, but I can. And then, but now I can see right away we have a problem here. You see what I see. This cannot be. Now that I have shortened this piece into a more suitable length. Well, I also got one heavy-duty washer. I actually parted it. There was 8 millimeters too much. I really don't know where I got the dimension that originally what was in my plan. But it was exactly 8 millimeters too much. So now, we try this again. So it goes there quite easily like that. And then we have this precision thing, which goes there into the taper. Like that, it's against the taper. And then we have a nut here. Like that. And now, we have a gap there, about 1 millimeter. That's a little bit too much for my liking, but better that than 8 millimeters too long. Well, this will do. The only purpose, purpose for this part is to protect the bearing, to protect it from the elements, all the stuff that is flying in here in the lathe. So that should do. Of course, a gap like that. That might call for some chips there, maybe, hopefully not. Well, that place where I'm planning to put it is not very, very. There is not much chips flying there, so it should be quite okay. So that's ready. Now, the next thing will be the pedestal. So now, starting to make the pedestal. This is just a workpiece, and I will first face it, and then there will be a 20 millimeter long portion with diameter. I have to reduce that to 13 millimeters, and then take care of the corners, etc. And then this side is ready. It's a very easy thing to do. Then I just turn it around and then beautify the other end. and well, basically there you are. There is nothing more to this piece in Lathe. Millimeter holes into this material, and now I have dialed this in. It's concentric with my dividing head, and it's at the moment it's also concentric with the spindle of the mill. So well, the radius of this bolt circle is 12.5 millimeters, so that would be my first task to move this 12.5 millimeters. So that would be 4, 8, 12 and 0.5. There, like that. after some deboring, well, there is still one thing I would like to do for this. It's not entirely necessary, but I think it enhances this to a better direction. What I would like to do is to make a recess here in the center, so that it's only contacting the cast iron with the rim. Because that surface might be a little bit uneven. So, let's make a recess. So, and again, this doesn't need to be exact, it just needs to be there. That's unexpected. Lock it there, and then let's touch it. The recess will be only 0.1 millimeters, so nothing much here, like that. And then, which direction does it feed? Let's see. Okay. And then I will go, there will be an intermittent cut, and I need my safety glasses. And this might cause some trouble, hopefully not. We shall see. Exactly, it's there. Good. Huh, that's it. Nothing more than that. After some nerve cracking drilling, I succeeded in making this whole pattern. These are all M6 threads, and none of these is true. So they are all blind holes, which is really, really good. But they are not very deep. Here is the piece that should be put into there. And then we have these cap screws, which go there. And this is the amount of thread they have there. Well, it's enough, actually. So, let's see now. Let's put this there. That, for example, first. And this I had to do these holes manually. So there is a little mismatch with this. Where is this now? There is a little mismatch between these hole patterns. So, but it goes there. Just take care that you don't thread it heavily at first. Just lightly, and then tighten it. So then it's okay. Like that, and then the last one. And why 6 bolts? This is because, and here you can see, this is really tight already. So, why 6 bolts? Because the thread is so shallow. That's the reason why. Now, let's and you shouldn't tighten these like crazy. Just so that they are there. And yeah, I know, we have paint there under. Well, I probably should have removed it, but I'm a lazy person, so I let the paint be there. Just checking that everybody is tight. I don't want to tighten them as crazy, really. This would be disastrous. Okay, now it's very steady there. And the next step is to put the dial there. So here is our ARO. So it goes into that hole like that. Should then go there, and now I will see that, well, it's a little bit, I will adjust this one so that it isn't let's see now. I want it to be like straight up. Well, it's still tight, man. I don't want it to be so loose that it loses my setting when I take it away from here. So it's about, should be about there. So, okay, now I can rotate it. Well, that's upright. Then I tighten it here in the back. There is this thing here. Now it doesn't move. So then I just put it here. And now we have a 17 millimeter. Now, the thing is that it should avoid colliding with this handle, but just barely. So I adjust it. So that's definitely wrong. So the space is so tight here that this must be. I believe that's the correct place. So when I tighten this nut here, it will stay when I now tighten it. Okay, now it's there. And it should avoid it. Yeah, there is 1 millimeter space in between. Yeah. And now it's there. And then this also, it collides with it, but it works. So now the next step here is to put you on frame. So the next step here is this spring, which goes here under. And you just put it there like that. And then you tighten this thing. And it should. And it did. And now it works already. And now this should be so that it doesn't touch it. Let's see now. One more here. Okay. Well, we have 1 millimeter. That's space. There you are, and then maybe this one should be a little bit tighter, but not a lot. This shouldn't be overdone. So now it's Yeah, it's there. Yeah. It works. Oh yeah, okay. Okay, I can... Yeah. It still can be rotated from here. It's, I believe this is the correct tightness. So, yeah. And then, the next thing I would like to measure. How accurate is this? I have now zeroed this, well, travel indicator, ARO. And I also have zeroed my compound here up. So it's touching the chuck. So now when I push the carriage with the chuck, I know exactly how much it will be moving. So now let's move first half a millimeter, just for the sake of it. There. That should be half. Well, what do you see? It looks like it indicates half a millimeter. Let's take one whole millimeter. And again, it's quite exactly what it should be. Now, let's take 3 millimeters. Ooh, like there. And it's still quite where it should be, I think. Let's take 9. So that is 6. That is 9. This is not very... So now it should be 9 millimeters. Okay, let's take the whole 10. And it still looks great. And then we have 90.
Exactly.
90. And then... yeah, almost. Installed an ARO into my lathe. And well, it's also surprisingly accurate. So, it helps. It really helps. You don't need the calipers all the time when you are like doing most of the tasks you do in a lathe. This accuracy is good enough. For length, for example. Okay. So, in the next episode of Finno-Greek Machining, we will be continuing with the cycloid drive. We are going to make the level the pins and the cover and, well, all that stuff. But, this will be in the next episode of Finno-Greek Machining. Till then, bye!